Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Jim Cobray.
I'm going to get down on my knees and pray because I need God, so do you. So come on, stand to your feet. Let's go before the Lord. Thank you, my brother. Father, we just come to you in the name of Jesus, giving you all the praise, all the glory, all the honor. Thank you for a great, mighty move of your Spirit in our hearts and our lives. We thank you, Father, that today we haven't come. We're smart enough to know that we haven't come into the house of God to hear from a man or woman. We haven't come to hear from a tall man or a short man. We haven't come to hear from a white man, black man, brown man. That's a stupid God. We have come to hear from the teacher of the church, the Holy Spirit. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Touch us, heal us, strengthen us. Encourage us, guide us, guard us, direct us, motivate us to be all that you'd have us to be. And Lord, we'll give you the praise, glory, and all the honor. Thank you, Father, for just a great, mighty move of your Spirit in our hearts and our lives. As you bless us today, we would ask that you bless all the churches in the Inland Empire. Bless our Baptist brothers and Lutherans and Methodists, Episcopalian, Charismatics, Pentecostals. Thank you for Calvary Chapels and Harvest, and thank you for The Well, The Way, Emmanuel, Ecclesia, all the great churches that are out there, Trinity. Father, we just bless them all. If they're preaching the gospel and hearing the gospel, they're our brothers. They're our sisters there. We want you to bless them as well as blessing us. And God will give you the praise. At no time, Lord, does the Rock Church and World Outreach Center think of itself as better than anyone else. We see ourselves as co-laborers, workers together in one field, building one kingdom, and that's yours, God. May the glory of God just pour upon all the churches everywhere, and especially this one we're speaking of, and we'll give you the praise. Jesus' mighty name, with a great big shout, we all say, amen. Amen. That's got to have to give me a bigger shout than that. That was a wimpy one. That's much better. I'm going to take you to Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verse number 36. I'm going to start to read this verse, and then I'm going to explain a little bit about it and how it works for you today. So I want you to listen, because again, I'm talking about your life and your future. If you could look into the heart of God for you, if you could find out what God wants for you. Now tell me, if you're a Christian, you've prayed many times, God, what's your will? What do you want me to do? How do you want me to act? Where do you want me to go? What do you want me to be? What do you want me to say? I just don't understand, God, with great passion. You've cried out. Today you can get some insight on what it is that God wants for you. Found in Hebrews, and by the way, as we go line upon line, precept upon precept, in the text of Hebrews, here's how it's going to work before I read. We're going to, this month, finish up the 10th chapter of Hebrews. I don't tell Pastor Dan or Pastor Luke what to preach or how to preach. I let the Holy Spirit be their teacher. They come out and be much greater than I can ever be. But what I always say is that if you see something in the Word of God and the Holy Spirit tells you to teach that, then you have the freedom to go ahead and do that. I trust them, and so should you. They're better than I'll ever be. And we're going to finish up the 10th chapter during the month of November. Because right after the 10th chapter, here's a great word of wisdom, comes the 11th chapter. And with the 11th chapter comes a whole lot of fun. That's our faith chapter. That's the one that's exciting. That's great shouting time, great encouragement time, great, you know, strengthening time for all of us in the 11th chapter. But we're not going to start that in December. We're going to start it November 1st. Sorry, January 1st. Because what we're going to do during the month of December is this. We're going to, if you will, teach on faith that it took for people to bring the Messiah to his place of birth. We're going to celebrate Christmas during the month of December. Now, for those of you that have a problem, please don't write me stupid emails, because let me tell you how it is. I'm just going to tear them up and throw them away because you don't understand some things. So let's be real upfront with you right now. I know about the Christmas trees being the tree of fertility and a demonic sign and pagan signs. That's not what our Christmas trees are about. They're about the celebration of the birth of the Messiah. Wait a minute. I also know that he wasn't born on December 25th, so please don't correct me about when he was born. But I also know that we have an opportunity to overlook this great event of his birth and never do anything or to celebrate. And we want to celebrate the birth of Jesus. And all of us should celebrate it with our children, with our families. And we're not doing it as a pagan holiday. We're doing it as a time of celebration, for the King has come and we ought to celebrate it. And so I don't want to hear any of that stuff. And so a whole month of December is a month of encouraging you to see the faith that went behind by people that brought the Messiah, that changed the world, that brought your salvation. And it's a good thing, not a bad thing. When December 25th rolls around, you will be doing more, thinking more, worshiping God more, and enjoying God more than you ever have before. And that's what December is going to be about. With that in mind, we go line upon line, precept upon precept in the Word of God. God wrote it that way. You ought to be able to understand it that way. And when you do, all of a sudden you grow to great maturity, understanding of the Word of God, because God wrote it for you to understand it that way. And it's going to be something that's going to be dynamic and wonderful for you. Before I give you the title of today's message, I'm going to read to you out of verse 36, 10th chapter. Go with me. And it says, for you have need of endurance, so that after you have done the will of God, you may receive the promise. Boy, that verse right there, we could spend the next 4 weeks just on that verse. We've already done a little bit, but we could do a whole lot more on that one. For yet, and here's my verse for today for you. For yet a little while, and he who is, notice the capital H in the word he who is coming will come. And he will not delay or tarry. I want to share with you that God has shared with me about his second coming. And that how you and I need to be prepared for Jesus coming. You and I need to understand that he's coming, know without a shadow of he's coming. We need to think about his coming all the time. And every day you're down, every day you go to work, every day that you feel frustrated, every day that you have consideration for your finances, for your family, your children, your wife, all the bosses, all the things and the heavy weights that you carry during the day, I want to teach you today how to cast your cares on he that cares, because there's one coming. And I want you to hear what I'm going to say, and I'll explain it to you in a moment. He's coming in your lifetime. And you say, wait a minute, Pastor. The Bible makes it very clear that no man knows the day, no man knows the hour. And I agree. Anybody that tells you the day or the hour, you ought not to follow them. They're very misled and very ignorant about the scripture. But I'm telling you, he's coming in your lifetime. He'll come one of two ways. He'll either come when the eastern sky splits, or he'll come at your bedside as you take your last breath. But either way, you're not going around again. I want you to hear what I'm going to say to you. You are not coming back as a frog or a lizard and work your way up the evolutionary scale. I can't even imagine anybody being that dumb to believe such things. We're on one life, and this is it, and he's coming one way or the other. And we need to be prepared for his coming. So today's message and the title is Good News of His Coming. It'll help you to focus in on what's truth. It'll help you to focus in on what's right. It'll help you today to get out of yourself and get into him. It'll help you to understand what your life here is on earth really all about. Listen closely as the word of God is expressed. He's coming. There is no doubt about it. He talks about it in the New Testament from the book of Matthew all the way through the book of Revelation. And everybody that's a Christian needs to know that Jesus Christ is on his way back. We don't know when, we don't know the hour, we don't know the time, but we assuredly know he is coming. And there's some things that you need to know that if he's coming, how should you and I be until the time when he does come? So let's take a look at the Word of God together. I'm going to give you an assignment this week, and if you will, Matthew, the 24th chapter. You ought to write that down somewhere, and when you're alone with God, just start reading it. It'll answer a lot of questions for you, maybe even give you some insight into answers, but also cause you to ask some questions, because the 24th chapter of Matthew talks about his coming, and Jesus himself is speaking. Not somebody else, but Jesus himself is speaking about his coming to his disciples. In the 24th chapter, I'm going to take you to verse 42, because there's something interesting about you and I that's expressed in these verses that are very important. If he's coming, I want you to hear closely. If you believe he's coming, then how should you be? Watch this, if you will, in verse number 42 of the Matthew 24. It says, watch therefore. And verse 42, I had you, if you will, if you've got your Bible or you can underline it in your iPad, you ought to underline or make a note of this word, watch therefore. God is interested in us watching for something. I'll talk about that a little bit more in a few moments. For you did not know what hour your Lord is coming. But know this, verse 43, if the master of the house had known what hour the thief, you ought to circle the word thief, it's an interesting word, the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. In other words, he's talking about Jesus coming, and he's saying it's going to be a time when you don't expect it, is what he just said. It'll absolutely shock you, the time when it comes. You will absolutely feel, wow, this is the most unusual thing that's taking place, verse 44. Therefore, you also be ready. And I love this word ready. Can I just say this to you? Let me say it again to you. Therefore, because of what I just said, you don't know the day and hour. You know he's coming. But then he comes along and he says, because you don't know that, you need to be ready. You need to know something about the Rock Church World Outreach Center that a lot of people don't know. We don't preach in this church pre-rapture. We don't preach mid-rapture. And we don't preach post-rapture. In fact, if you study pre, mid, and post-rapture, rapture means the taking away of the church. Pre, before the tribulation. Mid, while it's ongoing. Post means after the problems and pressures of the world. Well, can I just say this to you? If you study all three theology understandings, you will find there is substantial evidence for all three to possibly work. We've just taken the one that's pre-rapture, and I hope it is pre-rapture. That means before any trouble, any trial, pressure, I hope Jesus comes, and I'm 100% for that, boy. We ought to all hope that's the way it is. But may I say this to you about the Rock? We're different. We don't preach pre-rapture, mid-rapture, or post-rapture. We preach ready rapture. My job is, and I'm going to tell you something, I want to be a good pastor that cares about you. I want to be a good pastor that tells you the truth. I want to be a good pastor that gets in your face and kicks your butt, if I have to get you into heaven and make sure you get there. I'm not a love boat captain. You want a love boat captain? There's a lot of love boat captains out there. You can find one that'll cuddle you through the whole thing, and I hope you make it. This is not a love boat captain. I'm going to tell you how it is, and we're getting you ready no matter what happens. This isn't what I'm saying to you now. We're getting ready no matter what happens, that you will be ready when Jesus comes. That's got to be important to all of you. So I'm not going there with you, but notice that therefore also be ready. For the Son of Man is coming at an hour that you do not expect it. Verse number, if you will, 45. Notice what it says in verse 45. Then when he... who then is a faithful and wise servant? This is so fascinating. He describes two conditions when Jesus comes that he's going to be looking for. He describes number one in verse number 45, who is a faithful and wise servant. Who then is a faithful and wise servant whom the master made ruler over his house to give them food in due season. Blessed is the servant whom his master, when he comes, listen to the four words, will find so doing. Wait a minute. I hear there's a theology going around, you don't have to do anything. I hear there's a theology going around, sweep through the church, tickles your ears, you know, you don't have to do anything. But I want you to know something. If that's true, then why is God looking for somebody who is the servant, who is a faithful servant, who will find doing something? Let me tell you something. When you get saved, doesn't mean that grace takes care of everything. It does, but guess what? There's still a responsibility you and I have to do what God would have us to do, and it's all through the scripture. So he says these words. So will he find doing means what's he doing? Faithful and wise servant. He's looking for a faithful, wise servant. Will he find you? 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 Will he find me? When he comes and the sky's split, he comes for us as a faithful and wise servant. Or will he find us just doing our own thing, living our own life? Man, I tell you what, I don't know about you, but I want to do what he says. When he comes and finds me, I want to hear these words, don't you? Well done, good and faithful, what? Servant. My goodness sakes alive. Powerful words for us to say. Now, wait a minute. If he's coming, now stop thinking about this. You know he's coming. And when he comes, he wants to find us as a faithful and wise servant. Then what does a faithful and wise servant look like and act like? I mean, stop, think about it. For me to tell you that is one thing, but for me to show you so that you can get involved in this with your whole heart and your life, big difference. So let me rephrase the question just a little bit so you can get it. Let me say it again, let me repeat it to you. If he's coming, and you know he is, And he's looking for faithful, wise servants that are doing faithful, wise stuff, then what does that look like? What does it look like? Because what it looks like is what he's expecting me and you to be like, right? In order to find that out, let's take a look, if you will, 2 Peter, 3rd chapter. 2 Peter, instead of me just telling you what I think, let's find out what God thinks. 2 Peter, 3rd chapter, let's take a look at it in the Word of God. Peter writes under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit in 2 Peter, 3rd chapter, starting verse number 10. Because verse number 10, he makes a statement about the coming of the Lord. Verse 10, now watch this. Remember, stop. Everybody stop, look back up at me. We're talking about you. This is what God expects from you. Now, can I say this? You don't have to do anything. The question is, don't you want to do something? Don't you love him enough to want to do something? You don't have to do anything. You can just turn me off right now. Or you can find out what God expects from you, not from some preacher up in the pulpit area, but really, literally from the Word of God. So let's take a look at it again, okay? So what is it God wants? How can I be a faithful and wise servant? Wow. In these last days, knowing he's coming. Watch this. 2 Peter, 3rd chapter, starting in verse 10. But the day of the Lord, right there, he's coming, will come as a thief. Remember, I had you circle the word thief? Totally unexpected. You know, if a thief broke into your house tonight, you wouldn't expect him. You wouldn't think anything of it. If you knew he was coming, you'd be waiting for him. I have a 38. Make it very clear, he come in my house, I'm gonna shoot you, pray for you later. One thing, you did not break into some sissy pastor's house. Drop you like lead. You say, well, Pastor, you should be nice. I'll be nice after I shoot you. You know what I'm talking about. Some of your men don't understand that. And so here's the deal. If you knew a thief was coming, you wouldn't let him come. But just like you don't know he's there, at the strangest hour, he describes Jesus coming in your life and in my life, totally and completely unexpected. Let's look at the verse again. A thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away, great noise and elements will melt, and the fervent heat, both the earth and the works that are in it will be burned up. Ashes. Now you stop, you think about that. In other words, here's how it's gonna work. Everything you know is gonna fry. Gone. God says it's great for you to have a house. He wants you to have a house, but it's gonna burn. God says he wants you to have nice cars. He's gonna burn. God wants your business to be successful. But you know, bottom line, why kill yourself over it? It's gonna burn. And here's my point. We worry more about the stuff of our life today than the eternity of God that's waiting for us. We work harder to keep the material things that are all going to burn. My dad died. Not that it's funny, it's not. When he died some 25 years ago, I remember going through his stuff. When he went through his stuff, I was shocked. There was his, he had his dentures, you know, his bridge with his teeth. He didn't even take his teeth with him. Credit card, his wallet was there. Everything was gone. His keys were there. He took nothing with him. And you're gonna understand something about God. You were born naked in this world and you will leave with nothing. So why are you so uptight about the stuff? When in fact, what we ought to be watching out for, which is two words we said to look for, is we ought to be watching out for his coming. There's something about in the midst of my problems and trials. Everybody ever had problems and trials? Anybody besides me ever had prayers that don't get answered? What the heck is that all about? It's like my prayers didn't even go to the ceiling. They're already back on me. I'm like that with you. I'm just the same way, man. I don't know. Sometimes things just don't work the way that I think they ought to work out. But all of a sudden, when I'm in the midst of my frustration, if I stop and realize, man, he's coming, you know what happens? I get a smile on my face because it's all gonna burn. Ooh, glory. And nobody's gonna put that fire out. I don't know. Just kind of like, makes you laugh a little bit. You don't understand the diamond I bought my wife. That's great. It's gonna burn. You don't understand. I finally achieved getting a Rolex watch. Well, I got a Timex. They're both gonna burn. Oh, what's the difference? Either the mortuary's gonna get it or God's gonna burn it. One way or the other. We ought to be happy about this. So anyway, let's move on before I get all out of shape here. Verse number 11, therefore, in other words, because it's all gonna burn, since all of these things will be dissolved. See the word dissolved up there means, since these things are going to come to pass. Guys, can I tell you something? You can't go to the bank on a lot of things, but you can go to the bank on what God says. Life changes all the time, but God never changes. And you know, so it's because since these things are dissolved, it's gonna come to pass. Now watch this. What manner of person ought you and I to be? In other words, if he's coming, Eastern sky's splitting, he's coming for us sometime, how should we be? And he tells us four things. Remember, we're talking about faithful, wise stewards. You want to be a faithful, wise steward? Here's how to be. Number one, holy conduct. Number two, godliness. Next verse, number 12. Looking forward, one translation says. In other words, we're watching for. And then hastening the coming of the day of the Lord. Four things to do. So, simple, wise, faithful servant. Let's talk about them just for a moment. Is that okay? Because if we're going to tell you what to do, let's tell you how to do it. Number one, go back if you will, verse number 11, holy conduct. Holy conduct means that my conduct in life, my actions, my activities, the way I live my life has to be set aside to Him. Listen. Not Him being set aside for me. This is not a life about me. It's a life about Him. And holy conduct means, the word holy means set aside or separate to, or it really means, I like this, exclusively His. That my conduct ought to be something that reflects exclusively His desire, His will, His plan for my life. That's what it means. If I'm going to be that faithful, wise servant that He's going to come looking for, then my conduct. So a lot of people say you don't have to do anything. You know, grace got you covered. Oh, well then, why is it there? So don't even go there with me. That's like the stupidest, that's like the 10 virgins. Five got oil, five don't. They're all looking for the same one to come. And guess what? Five didn't make it because they weren't prepared. I'm preparing you. For the word of God makes it very clear. Don't get caught up in this modern day theology. If you want to go back to Gene Scott smoking a cigar on television, it was the exact same stuff that was being preached by him. And it was wrong then and it's wrong today. Don't let anybody talk you into it. Foolish thinking, foolish theology. Because God says if I'm saved, I ought to act a certain way. And my conduct ought to be wholly, exclusively His. He says it. Exclusively His. Exclusively His. His. I ought to act what He wants. I ought to treat my wife the way He wants me to treat my wife. I ought to do my business the way He wants me to do my business. I ought to cast my cares the way He wants me to cast my cares. I want to live for Him instead of living for me. When you live for yourself, inviting Him into your life, it's not enough. It's really living for Him and He comes into your life. Let me say that like this. The Bible says in Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and then all these things will be added onto you. First step is you seeking God. And then in His righteousness, and then all these things are added on. What we want is the things first, and then we want to put God in there. Doesn't work that way, my friends. Give me the blessings and then I'll serve you. No, you serve me, you'll get the blessings. Is anybody listening? Come on, let's get this straightened out. Very important for us to see holy conduct. Listen, go with me, if you will, into 1 Timothy, the 6th chapter. Hold your place there at 2 Peter. We're going to come right back there. But 1 Timothy, if you will, the 6th chapter. Let me read a couple of verses for you. It's kind of neat verses, starting verse number 11. Now, wait a minute. I'm going to warn you before I get into these verses. Will you listen to me just for a moment? There's a lot of verses here that are saying a lot of things. And sometimes when I say a lot of things, your mind starts to wander. And you don't get it. So kind of try to stay tuned with me, because I'm going to show you what a faithful, wise servant does in their holy conduct. Is that okay? Because I need to know what the holy conduct really is. Yes, it's doing things God's way. Yes, it's His plan, His will, His desire, His want. Not mine, but His. Now watch how it works. Let's take a look, if you will, in 1 Timothy. Here's Paul writing Timothy as he pastors a great church at Ephesus. And he's giving him insight on how to do life, how to do church, and how to take care of the people. And he writes these words, verse number 11. But you, O man of God, flee these things and pursue righteousness. Wait a minute. Notice what he's saying. He's saying all the perversion of the world, if you read the verses before that. And then he says, O man of God, flee these things and pursue. In other words, I've got to pursue. I've got to go after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, and gentleness. Verse number 12, fight a good fight of faith. Lay hold to eternal life, in which you are called to have a confession of good confessions in the presence of many witnesses. And now he comes along and says, if you're going to be a wise and faithful steward, servant, then you're going to have to be somebody who's going to walk in faith pursuing the things of God. What for? So you can be a witness to a lost and dying world. And all of a sudden, not only God sees me, but the world around me sees me. Then he comes along, verse number 13, he uses Jesus as an example. Verse number 13, I urge you in the sight of God who gives life to all and before Christ Jesus, who witnessed once again a good confession before Pontius Pilate. He's ready to die. He's going to lay his life down. He holds fast to the things of God. They crucify him to the cross and he stays with his witness to a lost and dying world. And he's looking for people like you and I to become witnesses to a lost and dying world. How? Through our holy conduct, not just preaching, not just open your mouth, but did you know your lifestyle will speak a whole lot more than your mouth? Come on, somebody. You know it's true. And then he says in verse 14, watch this, that you keep this commandment. What commandment? Go after the things of God. Walk in faith. Be a witness. In other words, you're going to be that faithful, wise steward that he's talking about, without spot, blameless, until the Lord Jesus is appearing. And all of a sudden, until he comes, that's what you and I ought to be doing. If you will, go back with me to 2 Peter. Let's take a look at verse number 11, if you will. 2 Peter, verse number 11. And it says, therefore, since all these things are going to happen, what manner of person ought you to be? In other words, remember, he's coming. He's going to be looking for somebody who's a faithful, wise servant. Faithful, wise servant. What's a faithful, wise servant? We just found out. Holy conduct. Your conduct needs to be like what God wants you to be. Now watch this. Then he says, and godliness. You know what godliness means? God-likeness. Did you ever think for a moment that God wants to use you as a witness because you're like God? Did you know that you, maybe not you, but you and you are distributors of God's goodness upon this planet? You have the exclusive distribution contract with God being saved to distribute his goodness. They're going to look at what you do, and now you're going to look like Jesus. And you're going to be one who represents him. What does Jesus look like? Merciful, kind, loving, oh yeah, blunt. Don't let people get away with stuff they shouldn't be getting away with. Caring about a people enough to say something, but teaching, full of love. And one of the great attributes of God is giving. You cannot outgive God. And when you give for the betterment of someone else, that's real love. When you give because you care about people more than you care about yourself. You know, a lot of people give so they can get. That's not what giving's about. You give because you love them, and you much rather have them have a blessing more than you have the blessing. When you have that kind of attitude, you have a God-like an attitude. And can I say something? It kind of like awakens God towards you. And you can't outgive God. God will give back to you in greater measure. You can't outgive God. But let me tell you something. When you give of yourself for someone else, when you take something you don't want to do, take something that you have and you give it for something else, for somebody else, for caring because of somebody else, God will bless you back in magnificent fulfillment in life, and it's ahead of you. It is better to give than to receive. And we miss that all the time because we have an attitude that's a manly attitude, a physical, fleshly attitude that says, I want to receive instead of giving. It's all about giving, my friends. It's all about loving. And guess what? Giving to people you don't even know is the best kind of giving there is. I can always give to people I love, but how about giving to people I don't love? That's what Jesus did, for we were yet sinners. And guess what? He gave his only begotten son to people that were unlovable. That's what love is all about. When we become godly like that, we become givers of ourselves for people. Can I say something to you? All of a sudden, the world wakes up and you become the witness that God is calling you to be. Is anybody listening? But listen, not only is that fun, but let's go to verse number 12 and we'll close this up real quick. Notice in verse number 12, looking for. Remember I had you back in Matthew 24, 42. Could I just pop up Matthew, the verse 42 of the chapter? Remember, watching therefore. Have you ever thought about going back now to Peter, if you will? Go back to Peter. Let's go back to Peter. Looking for. Have you ever wondered what you're looking for during the day? Maybe what you're looking for during the day is depressing you during the night. Maybe what you're looking for during the day is stopping you for tomorrow. Maybe you're putting too much on the day looking for the wrong things. Sometimes we're looking for results instead of looking for the reality. In other words, God says we're to be watchful. We're to look out for. We're to be looking forward. And as I said earlier, I can be under a welt of stress, pressure, and trials can be on me. You know, every day there's responsibilities that are beyond my ability. I've got to mount up to it and get going on it. I mean, I tell you, there's all kinds of pressures. And those pressures that are on you need to be put on Jesus, and you need to also watch that today can be the day that Jesus comes. And I want you to know, when you're watching for Jesus, you're going to be happy again. Somehow, when you watch for Jesus, your face goes from a frown to a smile, because Jesus is coming. We ought to have people that don't just look at today, but we ought to be watching every day for his coming. Come on, somebody. Watching for Jesus. And then I love this last part, number four, of what a faithful, listen to this, if you will, wise servant looks like. Number four, hastening the coming of the day of God. Can I say something? This is the only place in the Bible that is an amazing statement. You know, did you know, did you know, one more time, I want you to get it. Did you know you can hasten? That means speed up the time of his coming. Oh my goodness. When I first realized that, I'd never seen it before. Debbie and I were talking maybe a quarter of a century ago, and we said, oh my goodness, we could actually speed up the time of his coming. That's why they say, Maranatha, come quickly, God. We want you to come, God. Yeah, there's people that need to get saved. There's people that need to hear. And I know that. And you've got all that part under control. But God, I just want you to come. I can speed up the time. You say, well, Pastor Jim, how can I hasten the day of the Lord? How can I, me by myself, how can I possibly speed up the time of his coming? Here's how. By being the witness to a lost and dying world of the goodness of God. Being his mouthpiece, being his heart, being his shoulders, being his arms, being his legs, carrying forth the goodness of God to a lost and dying people that are hurting out there and so arrogant in their pride, they don't even know that they're lost and don't even care. But all of a sudden, when you start to tell them about Jesus, they start to see your lifestyle. They start to see and experience your godliness. You will change the world that you live in, and you can hasten the time of the Lord. Come on, somebody. Powerful understandings. The heavens are going to pass away. It's all going to burn. How should we live our life? How can we be wise and faithful servants of God? Holy conduct. Godliness. looking for him every day will help you to do that. And then be what God's called you to be. So simple. And yet, guess what? Can I promise you this? I'll promise you one thing. He's coming. And it might even be today. Come on, somebody. Give the Lord a great big praise. Woo! So let's work for him. Come on. Yeah, it hurts. Come on, let's work for him. Yes, I know it's not easy. I know it's not fun. But you keep on keeping on. God's so good. Before we go any further, I want to make sure everybody's right with God. That's what's most important in this place right now. Some of you, when I mention here, check your own heart. It's a little test for you. He's coming. It could be any moment you went, oh my goodness. I hope he doesn't come because I don't know if I'm ready. Let's get you ready. Everybody remain seated. Where are you going, everybody? Stop getting up and leaving. My church isn't over yet. Now, I'm going to be tough on you if you get up and leave again during church service. The Holy Spirit's moving. And you want God to move in your life and you're walking out on the Holy Spirit. Somebody needs to love you enough to tell you that's wrong. Sit down. We're talking about your soul right now. I don't want you to leave this place today. Go out and die and open your eyes in hell. I want you to get right with God. He's coming, and you need to be right with God before he comes. And today, before we go any further, let's make sure you're right with God. I want you to examine yourself. I want you to check yourself out. I want you to see where you're at. If you were to die in the next few minutes, just drop dead, boom, your heart stopped. Ask yourself this question. Would you go to heaven? Or would you go to hell? Answer the question in your heart. Nobody will know but you and God. Ask yourself that question. Would I go to heaven or would I go to hell? Now, those of you that said you're going to heaven, what makes you think you're going to heaven? Some of you said, well, I think I'd make it if I go and die in the next few minutes. Can I tell you something? Nowhere in the Bible does it say you can think your way into heaven. Like whoever's a positive thinker, you're not going to make it. Some of you are in here and you're saying to yourself, well, I hope if I died, I'd go to heaven. I hope I'd make it. Guess what? Nowhere in the Bible does it say you hope your way. It's not in the Bible. You're not going to make it if you hope your way into heaven. Not going to make it. Some of you said, wait a minute, I love God a whole lot, Pastor Jim. I'm going to go to heaven because I love God. Guess what? Nowhere in the Bible said because you love God, you get to go to heaven. You're not going to make it. Not going to make it. You know those guys that crash airplanes in the World Trade Center? Their last words is, we love you, God. Here's the problem. Wrong God, wrong way to show love. They're in hell, I can tell you, according to the Bible. So you can't say you love God and you think you're going to go to heaven because you love God. Nowhere in the Bible says you get to heaven because you love God. So how are you going to make it to heaven? You say, wait a minute. My mom and dad told me I was a Christian when I was a kid. They took me to catechism class, Sunday school, Sabbath school class when I was a child. Great. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say because you went to those classes, your mom and dad told you you were a Christian, you get to go to heaven? It's not in the Bible. You're not going to make it. You say, wait a minute, Pastor Jim. You don't understand. I joined my last church, sang in a choir. Helped the pastor out, carried the Bible for him. I counted the offering. I was a leader in my church. Great. Can I tell you something? Nowhere in the Bible says you get to go to heaven because you say you're a leader in the church, sang in a choir, helped the pastor. It's not in the Bible. Listen, if you're going to get to heaven, you're going to have to get to heaven God's way. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Now watch what else he says. No man goes to the Father except by me. You can't make it any other way. You're not going to make it on your own. You're not going to make it my way. You're not going to make it some well-meaning church committee's way. You're going to have to get to heaven his way. And today, here you are. You have a divine appointment with God today. God brought you here for this reason. You say, wait a minute, Pastor Jim, how do I get to heaven? You're going to have to follow Jesus. Jesus said it like this in John, the third chapter, just so you would know, you must be born again. Cut out all the baloney about being born again. That's Hollywood. telling you what born-again people are like. They portray us as idiots and fools. But I'm here to tell you something. It's not about being an idiot and a fool. It's about surrendering all of your heart and giving God all of your life. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's about you giving God all of your heart, you giving God all of your life. Listen to me. It's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. All or nothing. I'll prove it to you by the scripture. Last book in the Bible, book of Revelation. Listen to this. Jesus is speaking. He says, I'm coming again. Isn't that not our subject today? Jesus is speaking. Last book in the Bible. I'm coming again. And when I come, I better find you hot or I better find you cold. Because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. Wow. What did he just really say? People who call themselves Christians that are lukewarm are not real Christians at all. And you're not gonna make it. Well, let's define for you what's lukewarm. See if this fits for you. Little in, little out, little up, little down, token prayer. You know, God is something, but he's not everything. Oh, how about this one? You're not against God. Oh no, you're not against God. But the problem with it is you're not wholehearted for God. That's lukewarm, my friend, and you're not gonna make it. God is just something like everything else in your life that's important, but he's not first thing, he's just something important. Lukewarm, you're not gonna make it. Somebody needs to love you enough and pastor you enough with truth to tell you the truth. You're going to die. And as uncomfortable as this is, you're going to go to hell if you don't get right with God. And today is your day of salvation. And I love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough to get in your face and tell you the truth. Honor you enough to stop playing games. I don't want to sprinkle you with incense. I don't want to throw holy nothing on you, blow smoke in your face, or blow smoke anywhere else. I want to tell you the truth. You need to get right with God by giving God all of your heart, giving God all of your life, or you're not going to make it. And when the eastern sky splits, you're going to be left behind. And you don't want that. So here you are today in a safe, friendly place. We've laughed, we've sung, think about it. You were great listening to the Word of God. Now listen to me. Today, I haven't seen you like this attentive in a long time. You are great. That won't get you into heaven. No, no. It'll only wise you up. What gets you into heaven is whether you've given God all of your heart, whether you've given God all of your life. It's all about him. And that's your heart. And only you can give it. I can't make you do it. Nobody can do it. He can't even hit you in the head. He could make you do it, but you wouldn't do it from your heart. You do it because you were made. He gave you a free will choice to make the choice. All across this auditorium, you say to me, Pastor Jim, how do I do this? How do I give God all my heart, give God all my life? Well, let's do it his way, not my way or your way. He said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you as mine before my Father. But if you deny me, I'll deny you. I'm a man, in a moment I'll see you put your hand up and you put it right back down. How simple is that? Because he said, if you confess me, I'll confess you. All across this auditorium, wherever you're at, listen to what I'm going to say to you. If you've never given him all of your heart, if you've never given him all of your life, I'm speaking to you, get ready to put your hand up. If you're one of those people that are not sure, make sure. If you're one of those people that are in here and you're saying to yourself, I prayed with Billy Graham, Pastor. I prayed with, Harvest Crusade. Hey, that's great. Great people, great prayer. But did you follow up the prayer with all of your heart and life? Or is it just a token abracadabra? Watch this magical formula of words you're hoping to get into heaven because you said the right grouping of words. God's not stupid, so stop treating him like he's an idiot. So today is your day of salvation. All across this auditorium, in a moment, I'm gonna count to three. I'll go one, two, three, and I'll go bang. When you hear that sound, bang, your hand goes up. I'll see your hand go up. And then you could put it right back down. Is that okay? How simple is that? You say, wait a minute, Pastor, I can raise my hand. I'll be embarrassed. Back in the family room, I'll be embarrassed. People will see me. People I came with will see me. Yep, they will. Get over it. It's better to be embarrassed in a safe place like this than to be in hell forever and ever and ever and ever because you care more about what people see instead of what God sees. Today, I'm telling you, he's coming. And today, you need to be right with him. And today, I'm crying out to you to get right with him. I'm counting to three. Here it is. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. There's one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12. Thank you. 13, 14, 15. Thank you. Back over here. 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23. Thank you. 24. Thank you. Back over here. On this side, I didn't see anybody. 24, 25 on this side. Is there another one back here? 26. God bless you. Back here. There's 27 back over here. God bless you. Got you. Up on top, all the way to the top. I see you. 28. There's 29. There's 30 right there. Anybody else? Real quick. Is there another one back over here somewhere? Wave at me so I can see your hand. There's 30, 31, 32. Wow. Come on. There's another one. Anybody else? Real quick. Don't miss this opportunity. He's coming. There's another one. 32, 33. Thank you. 34. Thank you. Wow. Well, what do you say? Let's give the Lord a great big hand for 34 wise people giving their heart and life to Jesus Christ. Isn't God good? Here's what I want from all 34 of you. I want you to do something that's wise. Nobody leave during this period of time. Hey, we haven't received tithes and offerings yet. And we need to pay some bills. So don't leave. Because the ushers are going to beat the snot out of you in the foyer if you leave. So we want you, all 34 of you, I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible friend. I want you to get out of your seat. If you raise your hand, you're serious about God, serious about God. I want you to get your stuff. Bring a friend if you need a friend. Get in, out of your seat. Get in the aisle. Meet me right here in front. No, wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute. If you didn't raise your hand, but you know you should have. There's a bunch more of you. You can get your stuff, check with your neighbor, give them the elbow, say, come on, I'll go with you if you need to go. Doesn't matter where you think they're at, just say that to them, and guess what? And let's go, come on. You get out of your seat. Let's thank God for them coming right now. Come on, give the Lord a great big praise.
Jesus, I believe in you. Jesus, I belong.
Man, all you guys up front, thank God you've come. We're excited about you. Let me talk to you just for a moment. Number one, I want you to put a smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing. This is a good thing. And secondly, I want you to look to your left. See this guy waving at you. His name is Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is a really good guy. No weird stuff goes on, I promise you. He's going to do three things. Let me tell you what they are so you're not afraid. Number one. He's going to take you over there and beat the snot out of you. No, I'm only playing with you, sorry. He's going to pray with you. Is that okay? Number one, he's going to pray with you. You need to invite Jesus into your heart. You need to invite him in. He's a gentleman. Won't come in unless you invite him in. Is that okay? Secondly, listen to this. He's going to give you some free information, some free literature, simple reading. It's third grade reading level, third grade, just past Dick and Jane. How do I know? I wrote it. Tell you what to do next. Is that okay? Now you're a Christian. What should I do, God? read that little booklet and do what it says. I'm telling you, you'll be back in church. Third thing he's going to do, he's going to tell you about a program we have called Spiritual Personal Trainer. They're going to help you get strong in Jesus. Don't say no to that. Say yes to it. Meet your personal trainer for 5 weeks. They'll go over scripture for you. Hey, they'll pray for you. Meet them at church. Buy you a cup of coffee or tea or something. And guess what? You're going to get strong in Jesus. And then you can bring your family. People have a revival in your city. I'm telling you, great things ahead of you. God, listen to me, wants to bless you. Don't go back doing what you used to. Go on with God and watch God bless you. It's time to be blessed. Somebody say amen. Okay, all of you, make a left turn. Make a left turn. Follow Joel right over that way. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.